This is Thomas Alsop, 176 pages of comic book art produced by me in the past year, 8 covers, sketches, thumbnails, character sketches, locations, research. I didn't do the script. Chris Miscavige wrote the story, but I have all the printed scripts in here with all my notes, and it's a crazy amount of work this represents to me. And whenever you finish something big, it can be a good idea to kind of evaluate and see what you've learned from that. So that's what this video is about. It's basically a note to self, but hopefully there's something in here for you as well. I also share probably the biggest hack, the biggest mind hack of my entire career, the biggest lesson that I've learned. So stay tuned for that by the end of this video. Every time I sat down to do the next issue of Thomas Alsop, I always had this little voice inside my head saying, I can't do this. This is why does anyone think I could possibly pull this off? I mean, 22 pages of comics in 6 weeks? That's nuts. I can't do that. But apparently I can, but I need to remind myself that I can do this, and that's why I put up stuff on my wall that I have done in the past, to remind myself of the process behind that and what that felt like. And I remember specifically painting this cover and thinking, oh, this is going to turn out so badly. I can't possibly do this. But then, you know, it turned out to be one of my favorite covers of the series. So just all the time, I don't know if it's specifically creative people who get this fear and this doubt, but we certainly do. And putting stuff on my wall that I have done in the past kind of reminds me that I can do this, and helps me ignore that voice inside my head. So how long does it take to do a 22-page comic in full color? Well, I didn't really know because I'd never worked on comics full time, so this was definitely new to me, and I'm glad I had some people to help me out. I did a podcast interview with my old mentor and friend Peter Snibia, the Danish artist, and he gave the advice of certainly keeping a calendar and breaking down the every issue into processes. Like if you put in the date for the full finished 22-page full color comic, then you need to go back and say, well, how long does it take me to color it? So when do I need to start sketching this to make that final deadline of 5 weeks after, maybe? So you need to break down the process all the time, and it requires a great deal of focus and concentration, almost like riding a motorcycle, where you're so focused on the next thing, you're thinking ahead all the time, and it's really, really stressful, actually, to always be focusing on when to fit in between every obstacle in the way. I'm sure my family has felt this as well, but the calendar was just an invaluable tool for me to be able to see. Even if I get behind, I know that, well, these 2 days that I've lost because of sick kids or another paid gig that I couldn't turn down or whatever, that then means that next week I have these 4 pages more to finish. So to keep up with myself, So timing and keeping a schedule is essential. Making comics is a full-time profession for sure, but not every part of the process is equally exciting. There are certainly parts of the process that are so boring that it's almost driving me mad, like coloring on the computer. I also find that working on the computer, the PC, I don't know if you know this, but the PC actually stands for Procrastination Central. It's so easy to hop off whatever you're doing and check your email or your Facebook every 5 seconds. So what I'm doing is I'm trying to fill up my mind instead of just using the 80% of my mind and then have 20% left to worry about stuff or go online and check all sorts of stupid research, I can listen to podcasts or audiobooks just on my headphones, and I put that on, and then I forget time and place, and I can just concentrate on working. Yeah, I'm still trying to figure this one out, but it seems like at least half of the research that I do is a complete waste of time. Now all I have to do is figure out which half. So now it's time for that big mind hack thing that I promised you, probably the biggest lesson for me in my entire career. That has to do with mind tricks. Not Jedi mind tricks. It's not that I'm able to somehow conjure up something fantastic. It's more of a question of cheating my brain into believing whatever it is I'm doing is not important. That sounds wrong. It's not that it's not important. It is important, but it's not life and death important. I'm able to have some kind of looseness about it, and the how I do that is I trick my brain. 10 years ago, I remember when I was inking, that I was really cramped and trying to do perfectly because I knew that I'm not going to be able to do this and it's gonna screw up, and I was so afraid of failing, so I would screw it up, and now I remember when I painted this cover, it's upside down, I was on the phone. With my mom or something like that, and I had the phone wedged in between my shoulder and my ear like this, and I had a brush, and I remember I was slapping on paint like this, just blah, not seeming to care at all, and I remember thinking about it, probably because the phone call wasn't taking up all my my brain capacity, that this was new. I mean, this was a new sensation to be able to feel so loose about this process of making comics. And it's not just that I've improved as an artist, which is obvious that happens if you're working on it for as long as I have, but it's more of a question of my mindset, my approach, my process. So let me share my process with you for a second here. So when Chris sends me the script, I print it out, and let's see, here's something. And then I do the thumbnails on the actual script, just because it's right there. You know, you have the scene playing out, and then there's a little space you can doodle something there. But it's a doodle, right? So I don't care about this sketch right here. It's not important. Then when I'm doing the actual layouts, the breakdowns of the pages, I go a little larger. We have A4 over here. I'm in Copenhagen, Denmark, so we have A4. It doesn't matter. I'm trying to fit it to the U.S. format. But this is basically my rough sketches. It's done with blue. There's not much reason for that, really, other than it just feels nice to be working with a nice big pencil. I don't use a very sharp pencil. I just use it because this is just a rough sketch. This is just to get the layouts down. So I don't care about this either. I scan this in, then I put in borders and captions and speech balloons and whatnot, and then I print. Then I turn tone down my layout pages. I tone those down behind this the borders and when I'm working on the computer, I don't care about it either, because you know this caption right here, this can just move somewhere else. I'm not committed to putting it right there, not yet. I'm pushing the decisions ahead of me all the time, so but then again, I don't have to make many decisions because I've already done the breakdown. So I take this and I print it out and I start sketching right on top of my rough sketch. And this piece of paper here, you see, this is my sketched images from Thomas Alsop, and I don't care about this piece of paper. I don't care about it. It's just a printout. I can just print a new one. So when I'm doing the sketches, I can do some sketches here. I can do some sketches on the side if I want. I can do little arrows and as you can see, I do notes on top of this piece of paper because it doesn't matter. It only matters when I start inking. But it doesn't even matter then, because when I do the inking, of course I have all my I start with doing the borders and the captions and the speech balloons and all that. I start with that because that's the boring part, and then that's out of the way. And then I have these nice blanks to fill out, and I have my rough sketches that I can use to fill those out with, right? I mean, not the rough sketches. I have my sketched pages to fill that out with. So I do it on the light box. I sometimes flip the board to do backgrounds and stuff like that. But I ink it all in pencil. Why do I do that? Well, because there's something psychologically nice about painting with inking with a pencil, is the knowledge that I can just erase it if I make a mistake. So I don't care about it. I don't even care about the inking process because I'm doing it with a pencil. Then I take a backup because I'm not stupid. So I take a backup of my inks, scan that in just to have that. Then I start painting. But again, I know this is going to go into the computer afterwards. I know that I have a backup, so I don't really care about the painting either. So when I start painting a page, I go at it with a very light wash to begin with and just do these kind of almost random strokes. This is an actual original page, and as you can see, I obviously don't care about this since I'm painting all over it. But I try to do these random strokes just to kind of get something on the page and see if there's anything in there that I can work with. I'm trying to do it without thinking about it. When I go into the darker tones, obviously I need to be a little bit more focused on whatever it is I'm doing, the overall feel of the page and where the light is coming from and all that stuff. But as you can see, I don't really worry too much about staying within the borders and keeping out of the speech balloons, because I know I'm going to fix it in the computer later anyhow. So that's my way of not caring about the original painted art. I know it probably seems weird that I pretend not to care about the art that I'm producing. Of course I do care, but I've just found that the way to produce the best art is to try not to care too much about it, not to worry about producing greatness, to produce the perfect piece of art, because that's not how it appears. That's not how I make perfect art, if there is such a thing, which I don't believe there is. The thing I do is I try to not worry about it so much, and the moment I let go and not worry, that's when the art really works and becomes something better, and the process is a lot more enjoyable as well. So that's it for Thomas Alsop, at least for me. I've finished up my part of the work. Obviously for you, the book ends in January. You can still get the issues. Issue 6 is just out with one of my my all-time personal favorite covers. It's a great book that I'm really proud to have been part of. Chris, this goes out to you, man. Thanks so much for bringing me on this journey with you. Thanks for convincing me to go on this crazy mission, and to Boom Studios, thanks for taking us on, thanks for believing in us, thanks for all the great work you've done with the book. Any input you ever had was just spot on, and it's great that to have editors who are passionate and committed like you are. And to you, the readers, thanks so much for reading the book. Thanks for all the great reviews we've gotten. It's really humbling, and I know Chris feels the same way. We're just really, both of us, proud and happy. I'm very proud to have been part of this process, part of the project, and bringing the story of Thomas Alsop to you. So, yeah. And if you're just watching the video and don't give a rat's about Thomas Alsop, that's cool too. I hope you learned something from it. Thank you.
Thank you.